Hey guys, this is Vyom, Joshi with Superior North. Welcome back to my channel. Today we will be talking about ArcelorMittal, which is one of the world's largest integrated steel companies. In this video, we'll review the company's fundamentals and then try to find the intrinsic value of this company. So let's dive in and review ArcelorMittal.
Hey guys, I'm on QuickFS looking at ArcelorMittal. For business description, we can see that ArcelorMittal, together with its subsidiaries, operates as integrated steel and mining companies in the United States, Europe, and internationally. It offers semi-finished flat products, including slabs, finished flat products comprising plates, hot and cold rolled coils and sheets, hot dipped and electro-galvanized coils and sheets, tin plate and color-coated coils and sheets, semi-finished long products, such as blooms and billets, finished long products consisting of bars, wire rods, structural sections, rail, sheet piles, and wire products, and seamless and welded pipes and tubes. The company also provides mining products such as iron ore lumps, fines, concentrates, pellets, and sinter feeds, and coking coal. It sells its products to various customers in the automotive, appliance, engineering, construction, energy, and machinery industries through a centralized marketing organization as well as distributors. The company has iron ore mining activities in Brazil, Bosnia, Canada, Liberia, Mexico, South Africa, and Ukraine. ArcelorMittal SA was founded in 1976 and is headquartered in Luxembourg City, Luxembourg. Now let's look at the company's key statistics. The company's current PE is at 24.1. The price to book is at 0.3. Price to sales is 0.3. Looking at the capital structure, we can see that the company's asset to equity ratio is at 2.1. In other words, this means that the company has twice as many assets compared to its shareholders' equity. The company's debt to equity ratio is at 0.3, and the debt to asset ratio is at 0.1. If we compare ArcelorMittal's capital structure to U.S. Steel, U.S. Steel's asset-to-equity ratio is at 2.9, its debt-to-equity is at 0.9, and its debt-to-asset ratio is at 0.3. In other words, ArcelorMittal's capital structure is more conservative than that of U.S. Steel. Next, looking at the company's revenue. Back in 2014, the company's revenue was about $79 billion. It slowly was declining and got to a low of about $53 billion back in 2020. And since then, the company's revenue has been trending up. For the year 2023, it was at $68 billion. Next, looking at the gross profit. Gross profit is what is left once we subtract the cost of goods sold from the company's revenue. Back in 2014, the company's gross profit was about $6 billion. In 2020, it was about $4 billion. And in 2023, it's about $4.7 billion. Over the past 10 years, there was only 1 year back in 2015 when the company's gross profit was negative. Next, looking at the operating profit. Operating profit is what we get when we subtract the company's cost of goods sold and its operating expenses from the company's revenue. Back in 2014, the company's operating profit was at $3 billion. And for the year 2023, it's about $2.3 billion. If you look at the company's operating margin, for the year 2023, the company's operating margin was 3.4%. What this means is every $100 that the company made in sales, by the time it paid for its cost of goods and operating expenses, it had $3.4 left as profit. Next, looking at the earnings per share. Earnings is what we get once we subtract the cost of goods, operating expenses, non-operating expenses from the company's revenue. So it's the net income number, and then we divide that net income number by the shares outstanding, and that is how we get the earnings per share number. For the year 2023, the company's earnings per share was about $1.09 per share. Ever since the pandemic, that is after 2020, the company's earnings per share number has been positive. You can see that there was a sharp drop off in the company's earnings in 2023. This is driven by the decline in the demand for steel. So this is across the industry. Even U.S. Steel sees a decline like this in its earnings per share. And this is fairly common for a deep cyclical industry like the steel industry. Now, let's look at the company's key ratios. First, if you look at the company's capital structure, over the past 10 years, the company's asset-to-equity ratio has stayed fairly consistent. Ideally, we want to see the company's asset-to-equity ratio to be staying steady or decreasing. And we can see that ever since 2019, the company's asset-to-equity ratio has been trending down. Next, looking at the debt-to-equity ratio. This ratio gives us an idea of the company's debt to its shareholders' equity. Ideally, we want to see the company's debt to equity ratio to be less than 1.0. The lower the number is, the better, because it tells us that the company is not overextending itself. That is, it's not taking on more debt in order to finance its growth. ArcelorMittal's debt to equity ratio for the year 2023 is at 0.2. For US Steel, on the other hand, the debt to equity is at 0.4. So we can see that US Steel is a little bit more leveraged, has a little bit more debt compared to its equity than that of ArcelorMittal. Next, looking at the book value per share. The book value is what we get when we subtract the company's total assets from its total liabilities. So it's the same thing as the shareholders' equity. Back in 2014, the company's book value was about $45 billion. And for the year 2023, it's about $56 billion. If we compare this $56 billion to the company's current market cap, which is about $18 billion, we can see that the company is undervalued from a balance sheet or from a book value standpoint. Same with the tangible book value for the year 2023. The tangible book value is about $51 billion. And if we compare that to the company's current market cap, which is about $18 billion, we can see that the company is trading below its book value. From a valuation metric standpoint, we can see that the price to book is at 0.41 and price to sales is at 0.34. Ideally, we want the company's price to book and price to sales number to be below 1.0. It's even better if it's less than 0.5, as it tells us that we're buying an asset that is undervalued. If we compare the price to book and price to sales to that of US Steel, we can see that US Steel's price to book is at 0.98 and its price to sales is at 0.60. So from these two metrics, we can see that our margin of safety is higher if we were to invest in ArcelorMittal. Finally, let's focus on the cash flow, because at the end of the day, that is truly what matters, is how much cash is coming in and going out. We can see that the cash flow from operations is about $6.5 billion for the trailing 12 months. Over the past 10 years, the company's cash flow from operations has always been positive. Next, looking at the cash flow from investing, over the past 10 years, it has been a negative number. And this is certainly something we want to see, because we want companies to be investing in their assets. As these assets, the plant, property, and equipment, acquisitions, investments, and such, is what will be producing the revenue on the income sheet, and which will then cascade down to cash from operations. So investing, having negative numbers here, is important. And finally, cash flow from financing. We can see that for the trailing 12 months, the company's cash flow from financing is about $3.3 billion. Ideally, we want to see the company to not be issuing stock. Negative numbers are good, as it tells us that the company has been buying back its shares. Seeing the company buy back its shares is certainly beneficial for the existing shareholders, as now the existing shareholders have a bigger percentage, bigger proportion of ownership within the company. Next, for the net issuance of debt, we can see that the company took on some debt in 2022. However, over the past couple of years, the company has been paying back its debt. Finally, looking at the free cash flow. The free cash flow is what we get when we subtract the company's capital spending from its operating cash flow. Back in 2014, the company's free cash flow was about $205 million. And for the year 2023, it was about $3.75 billion. We won't be looking at the trailing 12-month free cash flow number, because every quarter is different. And so it's important to look at an annualized number, such as for the year 2023. And if we're trying to get a rudimentary picture of what the intrinsic value is, we can think about the free cash flow and divide it by the discount rate. And for the discount rate, let's just use the weighted average cost of capital for ArcelorMittal, which is about 10%. So what we do is we have $3.75 billion, and we divide that number by the discount rate, and what that gets us is $37 billion. And what this tells us is the company's current market cap, which is about $18 billion, and our intrinsic value, which is our free cash flow divided by the discount rate, which comes out to $37.5 billion, and we can see that there's a wide discrepancy. You know, $18 billion, which is what the current market cap is. That's what the company or the market currently thinks the company is valued at. And our valuation comes out to $37.5 billion, which tells us that the company is undervalued. Now, if you focus on the discounted free cash flow model for the year 2023, the company's free cash flow is about $3.75 billion. We assume the annual growth rate of free cash flow to be 2%. What this means is I'm expecting ArcelorMittal's free cash flow to grow at 2% every year for the next 10 years. Next, I'm using a discount rate of 11%. This is just a percentage above the weighted average cost of capital. The long-term growth rate, I'm using that to be 4.4%. This is in line with the 30-year U.S. Treasury yield. The company has about 797 million shares outstanding, and its long-term debt is at $8.348 billion. After taking all of these inputs into account, we get the company's intrinsic value to be about $49 per share. Now, the way we come up with this number is we sum up the discounted cash flows every year for the next 10 years. And then we look at what the discounted free cash flows would be from the 10-year mark into perpetuity. And the intrinsic value comes out to about $47.65 billion. And from a per share standpoint, the number comes out to about $49.32 per share. And if you compare this intrinsic value to the company's current stock price, which is about $23 per share, we can see that we would be buying this company at about 50% below its intrinsic value. Now, if you disregarded the perpetuity component, in other words, if you think that ArcelorMittal is only going to grow for the next 10 years at 2% annually, and then the company will cease to exist, then the company's intrinsic value comes out to about $20 per share. And if we disregard the debt, in other words, if you think that ArcelorMittal is going to grow from now into perpetuity, and the company does not really have to worry about its debt because it's going to just keep on growing, then the company's intrinsic value comes to about $60 per share. So if you look at the three pictures from a discounted free cash flow standpoint, DCF standpoint, growing the company at 2% annually and then growing it at 4.4% through perpetuity, the company's intrinsic value comes to about $47.6 billion. Then if you look at a rudimentary picture of free cash flow divided by the discount rate of 10%, that number comes to about $37.5 billion. And finally, if you look at the book value standpoint, it was about $50 billion. So $37.5 billion for the free cash flow, $50 billion for the book value, and then the DCF from a calculation standpoint on the Excel sheet comes to $47 billion. All these three numbers are much higher than the company's market cap, which is about $18 billion. The company's cash flows that as we saw are good. So from a cash flow standpoint, we know that the company is generating income, which is translating into cash from operations and free cash flow. All these numbers are positive. And from a capital structure standpoint, the company is conservative. It is not overextended to the point where the company's future is at risk. So overall, I think ArcelorMittal is an undervalued company, and Superior North has been buying shares of ArcelorMittal. Hey guys, that is all I had for you this week. Hopefully you found this video on ArcelorMittal interesting. If you like this content, please do like, share, comment, and subscribe. And if you have any suggestions on which stock I should review next, please leave it in the comment section below. I'd greatly appreciate it. Thank you.